Okay, great. I think we're going to kick off now. So welcome to everyone who's just joined us. My name's this evening by my colleagues Tim and Sarah and Abby, who's going to be personing the chat and fielding any kind of Q&As and keeping us on track as we go. Just before we start, I guess for people who don't know us, we're an organisation that campaigns for debt justice, both in terms of sort of personal debt that individuals have in the UK and also global debt internationally, and particularly in solidarity with countries in the global south. So that's largely what we're going to be touching on this evening. And I guess, yeah, just say that obviously since the pandemic has started, we've obviously seen some huge repercussions in those areas, and that's obviously in the context of the massive changes in fluctuations in global markets, the huge announcements that we've seen from our government here in the UK. So we're going to be sort of unpacking some of that, and Sarah is going to be talking largely to the issue of personal debt and kind of the debt that households have in the UK, and Tim is then going to be talking a bit more about Global South debt as well. But just before we kick off, and I can see some people are doing this already, but we've got, I think, about 100 or so people on the call with us already. And I was just wondering if people would like to say hello just in the chat box, just down. I think we've got people from all over the UK and probably overseas as well joining. So, yeah, if you'd like to just say hi to your fellow webinar attendees. hello from all of us as well. If you have a question at any point, then please, we took some questions in advance, so thank you very much for that, which we'll try and incorporate into what we're saying, but then we will have questions at the end, so please use the chat box or the Q&A box for that, because we can't hear you as we're kind of speaking. Oh, that's nice, we've got people from all over there. Okay, brilliant. So I think we will kick off now. I think we'll start with Sarah, if you maybe want to talk us through a bit about what's been happening in the UK and some of the campaigning we've been doing and what we've seen in terms of the situation for people's personal debt in the context of coronavirus. Cool, thank you.
Sure. Hi everyone. It's great to see so many people, even though we can't actually see you, but it's fantastic to have so many people on the call. These are obviously really difficult and unprecedented times for a lot of us. I'm going to start with a bit of context actually about where we were with personal debt in the UK just prior to the outbreak of the pandemic, because that's really, really important for understanding the impact that the pandemic has now had and the impact that the economic shock has now had. So as many of you know, as a country, we were already facing a profound crisis of poverty, of destitution and problem indebtedness prior to COVID-19. So prior to the outbreak of the pandemic, we already had 14 million people in this country who were in poverty. That's nearly 20% of our whole population. People struggling basically to buy basic living essentials to afford things like food, water, electricity and rent. That's 14 million people. That means a lot of people were already being pushed towards high cost lenders in order to just be able to make ends meet, and facing spiraling indebtedness as a result. And the upshot of that is that personal debt was also at its highest ever level just prior to the outbreak of the pandemic. So we had around 9 million people in this country in problem debt, meaning they were either struggling to make their payments on their debt or they were having to cut back on basic essentials in order to pay their debts. The average family in the UK owed around £14,000, not including mortgages. And in total, UK households owed around £223 billion in unsecured personal debt. Again, that's not including mortgages. So we were already facing a really significant household debt crisis, debt poverty trap, before the outbreak of COVID-19. That was the backdrop for what economists are now saying is the worst economic shock to hit the global economy for 150 years. So worse than the Great Depression in the 30s, worse than the 2008 financial crisis. And as you're all absolutely no doubt aware already, COVID has had really significant economic impacts here in the UK. It's effectively ground our economy to the halt. Lots of shops, lots of businesses have had to close. If people can't work from home, then basically businesses and organisations have had to put their operations on ice. And as Eva said, we've already seen some really big interventions by the government in response, interventions that would have seemed to a lot of us pretty unthinkable before the pandemic broke out. So these interventions have been geared towards basically trying to protect companies from going into total collapse because of the collapse in supply and demand and affecting their operations. So trying to keep them afloat, trying to stop them from laying off workers, trying to protect the self-employed, and also trying to, well, a little bit about supporting the people who are reliant on the social safety net. I'll talk a bit more about that in a minute. Key measures have been loans and grants to businesses, the job retention scheme, and a small uplift in universal credit and the local housing allowance. Unfortunately, despite the scale of these interventions and the speed, actually, with which they were introduced, we know it's already very clear that they're not going to be enough to stop COVID-19 from significantly deepening the household debt crisis in this country. We know that tens of thousands of layoffs have already been announced, tens of thousands, if not more, jobs have already been lost. Many companies are on the verge of bankruptcy now. Nearly a million people applied for universal credit in the first 2 weeks of the lockdown. So the headline really to start with is that the government's interventions so far are obviously welcome, but without further action, then we are going to see a deepening of household debt problems in this country. The critical point really around this is the fact that so many more people now are going to be reliant on our social safety net. And our social safety net has been reduced to threads by 10 years of austerity and cuts. Probably lots of people on this call are aware of how much benefits are nowadays, but probably maybe some of you aren't. So the standard allowance for universal credit before COVID-19 was £73 a week. That's a quarter of average income. Rishi Sunak put it up by about £20 a week. So it's now about £92 a week. That's obviously not enough to live on. There's some other support available in terms of housing benefits and things, but there's lots of caps on that as well. And on top of that, there's a 5-week wait for universal credit. So you have to wait for 5 weeks after applying before you can actually get it. And the government gives you a loan for that time, which you actually have to pay back. Other benefits are similarly completely unlivable. So carers allowance, job seekers allowance, all of these are somewhere in between £66 and £95 a week. That's simply not enough money for people to live on. And then there's all sorts of sanctions. So the government can claw back money directly from your payments, which means that some people are living on 2/3 of their universal credit allowance, like £60 a week. So we coordinate really closely with lots of debt advice providers. And again, even before COVID-19, they were saying they were seeing growing numbers of people coming in with what they call negative budgets. And that means just the money that they've got coming in won't cover their absolutely basic essentials. And they were saying that had a lot to do with the weaknesses of the social safety net. So really this crisis is shining a spotlight on the wholesale inadequacy of our social safety net and its inability to provide for our citizens in normal times, but particularly in times of national crisis. And the consequence is that a lot more people are going to fall into the debt trap. So what do we do about this? There's two real sort of types of solutions to this. We either get people more money or we reduce their costs. In terms of the first area, as Jubilee Debt Campaign, we've been supporting the work of lots of our allies and organisations who are focused on this issue of how do you just get more immediate cash transfers to the people who are needed, the people whose livelihoods are being affected by COVID-19. So the New Economics Foundation, the TUC, Open Democracy, they're all focused on something that's called a basic income guarantee, which means through the benefit system, just increasing the amount that people are getting through Social Security so that it's actually enough to live on. And the TUC has said that should be around 80% of the real living wage. We've been supporting signing on to lots of letters and supporting that work. We've also been signing on to lots of things and supporting work by Child Poverty Action Group, the Women's Budget Group, and others, where they're trying to tackle some of the really unfair penalties in the benefit system, so around the benefit cap and the two-child limit. As Jubilee Debt Campaign, we've been focused more on the reducing the cost side of the problem, and obviously because of we're a debt organisation, on reducing the cost relating to debt. So around 2 weeks ago, we led on a joint civil society letter to the Chancellor, which was signed by over 80 academics and leaders of charities and think tanks and trade unions, calling on him to take urgent further action to prevent the buildup of unfair and unsustainable debt because of the pandemic. So the letter put forward four key priority measures that we think it is important that the government takes to stop this spiraling debt trap. First was a freeze on repayments of all unsecured debt, so that's things like loans, credit cards, rent-to-own payments for the people who need it, so for people whose incomes have been dramatically affected by coronavirus, and crucially that this freeze would have no accrual of interest during the payment holiday. So while people can't repay their debts, they're not building up extra interest because of it. The letter also called for a freeze in utility, rent and council tax payments for those who needed it with no buildup of arrears, and for a write-off of council tax and security debts, and also for the suspension of all debt collection and enforcement activity with immediate effect. Another really horrible thing that we were hearing from our debt advice allies is that even when the lockdown was in force, and obviously all the particularly vulnerable people were trying to self-isolate, that we still had debt collectors going around and knocking on people's doors and asking them for money. And obviously there's lots of complaints of abusive behavior and aggressive behavior by debt collectors, which we need to tackle. So we got a big splash about the letter in the Financial Times, and also did lots of media work around it, and we've already seen actually some progress on this. So the Financial Conduct Authority, which is the bank's regulator, the regulator of all the banks and other lenders, has issued notice requiring banks and lenders to offer a 3-month payment holiday to those who need it, and that is now across all forms of consumer credit, so loans, credit cards, car finance, even high cost credit. And also requiring banks to provide a £500 interest-free overdraft to people who need it. However, the holiday that they're offering, while it's important, it provides people with some breathing space, the lenders are still allowed to charge interest on it, which basically means that people who are already in debt, if they need to take that payment holiday, they're going to get into even more debt because of COVID-19. And it means that the lenders are going to make more profits than they were if COVID-19 hadn't have happened. So obviously that's not good enough. And now we're working out what to do next. So the main thing that we're very clear about is that a bigger debt write-off is going to be needed. We needed actually a debt write-off for the poorest households, those who are most indebted, before all of this kicked off. Now we're going to see a lot more people getting into problem debt. It's absolutely certain that we're going to need a bigger debt write-off, both to support people who've been affected by this pandemic, but also to give the economy a real kick to try and kickstart economic recovery. But we know that writing off the debts to banks and private lenders is quite complicated. It's not necessarily the type of policy which would be most useful at this time. So one option is for us to push now for the write-off of the council tax and social security debt. We know that this would help the most vulnerable people. It's actually easier to implement because it's either done centrally by the government or through government transfers to local authorities. And it's also laying the ground for a much bigger write-off campaign when the debt impacts of COVID-19 become clearer, which we obviously know they will. But we also know that we need to look at the insolvency regime. So there's lots of barriers to entry for having your debts restructured. If you're in problem debt, you actually have to pay money, quite a lot of money, to enter some of these programs. And they're massively weighted towards interests of lenders. So they push people to keep repaying more than they should and more than they can afford. So we're looking at options now. We're really keen to hear your thoughts on what our priorities should be. What we do know is that COVID-19 is going to dramatically worsen the household debt crisis, but also it's a really big opportunity for us to push for some structural changes which will tackle unjust debt and stop more people getting into problem debt in future. Thank you. And obviously very happy to take lots of questions. Lots of you sent questions in advance, and that's great. But if other people have other questions, please put them in the chat box.
Brilliant. Thank you very much, Sarah. I think, as Abby was saying, I think we'll take questions at the end. And just to add that if you're putting a question in the chat box, you need to reply to all attendees and panelists. Otherwise, only we can see it, which is nice, but other people might want to see it also. I think maybe if there's any kind of burning questions now, or maybe take one or two just on UK issues and kind of household debt, just before we move on to the kind of global picture. So yes, Abby, which do you think, should I take one or two of those? I think we've got just a question there on if we cancel council tax debt, does that mean that local authorities will be left short? I think that might be quite a good one just to touch on.
Yeah, absolutely. No, so we one of the conditions for what we're proposing with the council tax write-off is that it's paid for by central government as part of the bailout package. We don't think that council should have to take the hit for it at this time. And actually, by cancelling council tax debt, we're actually helping local authorities by taking some of the burden off them as well, providing them with financing at this critical time. It's a really important point that councils don't bear responsibility for this. We think it's part of the wider failings of central government, and we think there's a strong case for part of a kind of wider bailout package.
Mm-hmm. Okay, great. And I can see a question there on student debt as well. I wonder, do you want to touch on that now? It's sort of a wider question. But.
Yeah, sure. So we definitely think there's a problem with student debt and the student finance system in this country. It's always been quite high up on our priority list to work on. But never quite made it to the top because we're a really small organisation with only six people. So we prioritised obviously the household debt issues, which are affecting people particularly on low incomes. Although we do know actually that student debt is increasingly a problem, not just around kind of justice, but also in relation to poverty. So we, in terms of our positions, support full grants, not loans, for university education. I think that's really important in terms of widening access for people, particularly working class people and people of colour. And we think there should be a write-off of student debt, basically the big student debt bubble that's already built up because of people having to pay loans and the big hikes in loans that we saw under the coalition government. We strongly support the calls which are coming at the moment from student nurses. So you see lots, as part of the withdrawal of support from students, we saw, was it the coalition government or the government after that, cutting the bursaries to nurses. So nurseries had to pay all of their fees and all of their own support. And so nurses basically on the breadline whilst working for the NHS during their training so that they can go and provide this really critical public service and taking on lots of debt as a result, which is absolutely completely unacceptable. So we really strongly support the call for cancellation of nurses' debts and wider calls for reform of the student finance system, which includes student debt write-off. Lots of people get sniffy about it because they say, oh, well, you know, mostly it's middle-class people who go to university. But actually, all the evidence evidence shows that the student finance system, because people have to take on loans, that is a really big factor in stopping people from poorer backgrounds and working class backgrounds from going to university, which means they're not then benefiting from all the life benefits you get from a university education, which then track to things like life expectancy, to income outcomes. So we think there's a really, really strong justice case for a student debt write-off as well.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And I'm wondering if you just want to maybe just touch on that issue of the collapse of Bright House, and whether that has had, what impact that has had. And then I think maybe Mary, I think we'll probably just come back to that question about positive money and how we're collaborating with other organisations. I think we'll come back to that a little bit later on. And then I think we'll go to Tim.
Yeah. So Bright House, for people who aren't aware, was a rent-to-own company. So one of the worst of the kind of reckless lenders targeting people on low incomes. So if you couldn't afford, if you can't afford to buy a sofa or a fridge or a freezer, one of the ways to get one of those things is to go to a rent-to-own company, and then you basically rent it from them until you've repaid what they consider to be the appropriate price. Often the sort of overall markup, people would end up paying, you know, double, sometimes more than if you were able to buy that piece of that household good outright. So they were really bad rip-off lenders. One of the wins that we've had from our campaigning in the last couple of years was getting a cap on the cost of credit for rent-to-own companies. So there was already a cap which had been won on payday lending, which meant that lenders could not charge more than twice. People wouldn't have to pay back more than twice what they originally borrowed, which meant a sort of cap on interest rates and charges. So we managed to get that same cap on rent to own, which was really exciting. That actually doesn't have anything to do with the collapse of Bright House. So the reason we've seen Bright House collapse is actually the same reason that we saw Wonga collapse, that lots of people put complaints into the financial ombudsman that they'd been missold credit by Bright House. And we know that there's widespread mis-selling across the whole of the high cost credit industry, where the lenders are not following the affordability guidance that the regulator has set out. So the regulator has said to lenders, when you lend to someone, you have to check that they can afford this debt, and you have to check that they can afford to pay it back. But they don't bother enforcing that. So they just leave it to the lenders to decide whether or not to do that, which obviously places most of the burden on repaying debts on the borrowers and no responsibility on the lenders. But there is a complaints mechanism, and we've seen more and more people using that complaints mechanism, and the lenders having to pay them back because of it. So the financial ombudsman going to Bright House and going to Wonga and say, look, you missold people these loans, you have to pay them back. And actually that is why we've had seen the collapse of Bright House and the collapse of Wonga, which in one way is good because it's removing one of the key actors of rip-off lending. On the other hand, it's removing one of the ways in which people on low incomes are able to access a form of credit. And unfortunately, there's not enough alternatives in terms of low interest, affordable credit for people on low incomes to make those kind of bigger purchases. So the government was about to start a no interest loan scheme and had some funding to do that, but has just decided to pause it for absolutely no reason. So one of the things that we're trying to do is support allies who are pushing for that expansion of affordable credit services. And obviously people are posting in the chat box about the role of credit unions. It's not been enough, by any means, enough support, government support for credit unions and the real ethical finance providers. And there's a real role for us in pushing for that as well. And what was the final question?
I think we'll come back to the other question of that. But yeah, cool. Yeah. Thank you very much for that, Sarah. Thanks for all the questions. Just to kind of wrap up a little bit, just before we move on to the international picture, I guess the key message is there really, you know, the UK was already in a household debt crisis even before coronavirus hit. We're going to see lots more people potentially getting into problem debt, and the system essentially is not in any way, shape or form fit for purpose. So we need to really be calling for fundamental reform of that system now to deal with what is going to be happening as a result of this crisis. But anyway, now we will move on to what has been happening internationally on in terms of debt. And Tim, I think you're going to take it from here.
Hi, everyone. Great to be with you this evening. It's great to see so many people on the call. Some of you I know and some names I recognise, and always good to be in touch. So to carry on the theme, really, even before the COVID crisis began, we had a debt crisis affecting many countries across the global south, and that was increasing. So this dates back over a decade to the last financial crisis, and one of the responses to that has been interest rates have been low in the Western world, and that led to a big jump in lending because speculators in the West were looking to be able to lend money to where they could make a lot more interest than they could in Europe or the US. And so there was this big boom in lending to developing countries. Then in 2014, the price of raw materials fell. So raw materials are things like oil and metals, and many countries in the global south are still dependent on these as their main income from the rest of the world. This dates back to colonialism, that when countries were colonized and European powers set their economies up to extract resources and sell products back to them. And despite independence, that economic system has carried on, and many countries have remain dependent on raw materials. And one of the problems with these is that they vary wildly in price. And in 2014, there was a big fall in the price, which meant that some countries were pushed towards a debt crisis, many others borrowed even more to try and cope with the impact. So that meant that over the last 10 years, debt payments across developing countries increased by 85% and were at their highest level since 2004. And we estimated that over 30 countries were already in a debt crisis. And those spending the most on debt payments, we'd started to realise were already cutting back on public spending. And so that was impacting health services, social protection. Countries like Mozambique, Ghana, Zambia were already in a crisis. And then the COVID crisis began, which obviously has the huge health impact, but has also had the huge economic impact globally. And one of the first things that happened was that as the Chinese economy slowed down, and then Western economies, the prices of commodities fell even further. So most dramatically is oil, which even on some contracts, the price has turned negative this week. But across all these kinds of goods, the price has fallen. So a potential income has fallen. And then there has been a big move of money out of developing countries back to richer Western countries. In technical terms, it's called a capital outflow, and it's the largest one that's ever been recorded in the global economy, as speculators have seen the money they'd invested in the global south as being now more risky, and they've moved it back to where they think it is safe in Europe and the US or Japan. Now, the impact of that is that it has pushed up the future borrowing costs for governments. So this is something we can see on financial markets. You can see how much the private lenders will charge governments to lend to them. And that interest rate has shot up through the roof. And actually, for many countries, they just won't be able to borrow on international financial markets anymore. And both some were using that borrowing to fund their governments, and many were depending on being able to borrow more to pay debts as they came due to be paid. And there are lots of other impacts. Obviously, as countries have implemented lockdown measures everywhere, that impacts on their economy, and so how much tax governments are collecting. And also remittances, money that is sent home from diaspora workers back to their home countries, are expected to drop off dramatically. And that's a big source of money in the global south. And before this crisis hit, we've estimated that 64 countries were already spending more on debt payments than on healthcare. And so this is a huge problem, the debt that is there, but it's also a potential huge source of money. If those debt payments can be stopped, then that is money that countries can have instead to spend on healthcare and social protection. Now, over the last few weeks, it has been a hectic few weeks of campaigning, media, and international diplomacy, as the debt has been put on the international agenda. Last week, the G20 finance ministers, so the G20 is the group of self-appointed most important countries in the world, and then there was the IMF and World Bank meetings as well, and they were discussing some measures to address the debt problems, and they agreed one concrete thing and then a couple of other things. So I'll talk you through those and then talk to where we think things could go next and what we're pushing for. So with debt, there are three different groupings of debt for countries. So the first one is debt owed to other governments. And last week, the G20 have offered to suspend those payments for 77 countries in the global south. And that, if it happens, will save those countries $12 billion this year. So it does save them money now. It is only a suspension, though. So those payments will then, at the moment, be due to be paid in between 2022 and 2024. So it creates this big wall of problem debt payments in the future. Most of the impact of that is actually borne by China. So of the $12 billion, only $3 billion of payments are to Western countries, and the rest is a lot is to China and maybe some other countries like Saudi Arabia. Then the G20 also called for private lenders to do the same. And so private lenders are lenders who've lent at the highest interest rates. It tends to be banks and specialist hedge funds. But this call is all very voluntary. And at the moment, we see no sign that it's going to happen, that those lenders are going to agree to suspend the debt payments. Or if they do, it will be very ad hoc for certain countries. And then the third group of lenders are called multilateral institutions. So the most famous ones are the IMF and World Bank, and then there are some others as well. We managed to get the IMF have agreed to cancel debt payments for some of the most impoverished countries. So it amounts to 25 countries for the next 6 months, but it could probably be extended for 2 years. That's worth $215 million at the moment, and then we'll get more the longer it goes on. The World Bank at the moment has refused to do anything, even to do the same suspension as the G20 governments, and we are pushing them to at least do the same. And so are countries like China, who are upset that they've suspended debt payments, but the World Bank haven't. So we see there's still a huge immediacy of trying to get the debt payments stopped now to help countries now. And the two main areas with that are these private debts and the multilateral debts. And actually, for those of us in the UK, we're weirdly in the most important country in the world when it comes to the private debts. So of, for example, African countries, 90% of their private debts are owed under UK law. So to actually make the private lenders do the same as the governments have done in suspending the debt payments, we would need to get a law passed in the UK. So we can make that happen, hopefully, if we build up enough campaigning and efforts in the UK. Similarly, within the IMF and World Bank, that's more of an international issue, but the UK is a major voice within both the IMF and especially the World Bank, because quite a lot of the UK's aid money goes through the World Bank. So we've got the immediacy of trying to get ideally those debt payments cancelled, but at the least suspended. And then we have especially if they're suspended, but whatever happens, a big problem of debts then coming due in a couple of years. And what we want is a massive debt write-off, but it done in a way that actually changes the system. So I think some of you will have been involved in our campaign for I've already seen some people in the chat referring to 1998 and the when we all gathered in Birmingham. So back 15 years ago, we got $130 billion of debt cancelled. And so we need a big amount of debt cancellation happening again, but this time we don't want just a one-off cancellation. We want to change the system to try and prevent these recurring crises happening. It's a fair point to say, why do we need to keep cancelling the debt? And we want the changes that will mean we don't have to keep cancelling debt, that we actually stop these crises happening in the first place. So it does feel like it is a crisis moment. It's really important, but also this is a chance for us to try and get some big changes. And it is on the international agenda. A lot of organizations have been getting in touch with us who are wanting to campaign on this issue again. And so it's really important that we work together to try and get some of these changes to international debt, which is ultimately about saving countries money and preventing them from having to go through these crises where they're not able to fund healthcare and other services. Thank you.
Great, thank you very much for that, Tim. And just say, yeah, I know lots of you, I think, will have been involved in the campaigning over the last few weeks. And I think about sort of 800,000 people globally sort of took action and signed petitions and got involved. So thank you very much for all of that. I think we've kind of really had a good combined impact. So just to pick up just a couple of questions. One that came through was just on why we don't think the World Bank is coughing up at the moment, which is, you know, something we've been wondering about also. But I don't know, do you want to come to that one first and then we'll take some others?
So firstly, it's not really about the money, because to do the same as the G20 have offered doesn't cost anything. Unfortunately, because they're just suspending and say it will need to be paid in the future, it doesn't have any, they don't need to account for it. We think the World Bank staff are resistant because I think they worry it's a slippery slope to eventually having to cancel some debts. And then there probably has not been enough pressure from the governments that ultimately decide what the World Bank do. So the World Bank staff aren't going to decide to do it, but the governments that own the World Bank can. And we know some of them are pushing for the World Bank to do the same, like China. We need to get more of those governments to do it. In some ways, it's a bit like that. Unfortunate that the governments have agreed to do the suspension before the World Bank was also made to agree, because that has changed some of the leverage in the negotiations, but we'll be amplifying the voices that are pointing out it is unfair that some governments are suspending debt payments, but the World Bank are not, and that ultimately it is governments, including the UK, as I say, have a very big voice in the World Bank. They are the number one funder of the part of the World Bank that lends or grants money to the poorest countries. And so we've got a sense the UK has been ambivalent on whether the World Bank should be included so far. We need to change the UK to championing the World Bank doing the suspension and then ultimately cancelling the debt.
Great, thank you. And then we've just sort of got a couple of questions about what we're not hearing a lot about COVID-19 and the impact on kind of global South countries at the moment in the media. So I guess, could you speak a little to that and say which are kind of most at risk, if, you know, in terms of the pandemic and also just in the situation around debt? And then we've also got some questions around the kind of private debt and why it is that so much of it is held under UK law, and also just what if anything the African Union is doing in the kind of broader conversations. So I think if you could take those three, that'd be great. And just whether, I guess, the just on the private one as well, we've got one on whether the 2010 Act can be extended. So maybe speaking a little to that also.
That's the kind of question I love. So why is this debt owed under UK law? So internationally, most debt contracts are either owed under New York law or UK law. And on average across governments, it works out about 50-50. And it's because creditors like the New York and London courts for enforcing judgments in their favour, and there is a history of them doing that. And so lenders insist, and when they give loans, we want this to be owed in New York or London. Why particularly then the UK is so dominant amongst poorer countries is that I don't know why, but there seems to be a regional balance. So African countries and lots in Asia, it tends to be owed under UK law, whereas Latin American countries tends to be New York law. And of these 77 countries that are in this G20 deal, there are countries from across the world, but it happens that many are under UK law, both African countries, but then also, say, Asian countries like Pakistan. The 2010 law is a law that Jubilee Debt Campaign got passed in 2010, and it forced private lenders to do the same debt cancellation as we'd won from the multilaterals and other governments for the poorest countries. We called it a vulture fund law. It stopped these companies called vulture funds from suing governments, but it applied to 40 countries that benefited from the debt relief we'd won, and it applied on their old loans. So it is, unfortunately, it doesn't help now because it doesn't apply to any of the lending that has happened since 2004. But it does help because it set a precedent that the UK can legislate to force private creditors to comply with internationally agreed debt deals. And so we very much want to build on that law and say, I amend that law, take the principle of that law, and then update it for the situation we have today. The African Union, I've not seen that much directly from the African Union, but African finance ministers have been very outspoken. They were one of the groups that really helped get this on the agenda a few weeks ago. They called for a moratorium on interest payments. And they have been particularly working through the UN Economic Commission for Africa. And I actually spoke to somebody at the UN Commission today, and we're hoping to coordinate a lot more in the future. So, I mean, I think the key point that I really is that a lot of the debtor governments have been speaking out, which is quite unusual because they often worry about their credit rating and the international perception. But it's definitely helped this get up the agenda that they've been doing that. I'm going to be honest and say I don't want to say too much about the health impact of COVID in the Global South, because I don't feel I'm the right person to talk about that. We've seen it is not, the spread has been slower or it's less advanced, but there are several countries where it is now spreading, and lots of countries that have brought in various kinds of lockdown measures. And that is in doing that in countries where there is a very large informal economy, in urban areas where housing is of very poor quality, people are living in very cramped conditions, is we can barely imagine what that would be like compared to what a lockdown is like for many of us here. And so it both has a much bigger personal impact on people, but it also has this huge economic impact. If most of your economy is informal and your government just does not have the finances to bring in the social protection measures that some countries in the West have been bringing in. We have to hope that the it does not spread, but the signs are unfortunately that it's starting to, and then the health systems that countries have are very limited. Some of the figures on how many ventilators countries have is just shocking. I think Central African Republic has just 3 ventilators in the whole country, and that comes back to why it's so urgent that we do everything we can to get money kept in countries now to support those governments in any way they can to improve health systems and the social protection.
Great, thank you for that, Tim. I think we'll just take a couple more questions specifically on the Global South, which I'll group together now from the chat, and then I think maybe we'll widen it back out to the kind of wider discussion again and have a few more questions at the end. There's a couple on household debt that we just need to respond to, but also just if there are broader questions or conversations that people want to have at that point. So just to kind of round off on Global South debt, we've got a couple of questions that are really, I guess, one that is, you know, should we even really be celebrating the suspension? Kind of, is that, you know, is that good enough? And just a couple also just touching on, okay, what are, you know, the debt that was cancelled 15 or so years ago, you know, how do we keep stopping this happening? And what, a couple of people asking, what are the structural changes that we need and what do we want to see to make sure that there's not, a, you know, rounds and rounds of debt crises?
So on the celebrating the suspension, I fully sympathetic with the question. We welcome the suspension because it does help now. There is up to $12 billion that will stay in countries that otherwise would have been spent on debt payments. And the fact that they even mentioned the private sector and kind of said that we want the private sector to be doing this as well was quite a step forward, certainly on what we were expecting a week or two before. And I think that the campaigning that lots of people were involved in helped to get that. But we're entirely clear that there is so much more that needs to be done. You're right, the suspension does not help in a couple of years when those debt payments come due to be paid. And there is all the debt that is at the moment likely to carry on being paid to the private lenders and the multilaterals. So I think we think it's important to recognize when there are changes and improvements that mean something, but also to be honest about how much more needs to be done. How do we stop it from happening? There is a lot of in this, and I'll try and summarize in a couple of areas quickly. So one of the problems we have with debt at the moment is that when a country gets into a crisis, the standard response is for the IMF and World Bank to lend more money. And that helps pay off the people who lent it originally. And in economics, they call this a moral hazard, that you're incentivizing lenders to keep acting recklessly because they know if a government can't pay, the IMF and World Bank will pay them instead. And we want, ultimately, one big solution to that is effectively a bankruptcy process for governments. So at the moment, there is no bankruptcy laws for governments. If a government owes a debt, it always owes a debt. And we want a system through the UN where if you have debt problems, you can go to that system, the UN, and then can independently say this is how much debt can be paid and all the creditors have to reduce it down to that level. So that would both help resolve the crisis, but it also helps prevent it because it forces lenders to have to be more responsible because they're not going to get bailed out. Even if we don't get that through the UN, there are changes to how the IMF and World Bank work, which some of you have engaged with that campaign recently, that we could get made that will mean that the IMF and World Bank stop doing these bailouts and that the original lenders have to take a hit. Another area we've been working on recently is around transparency, which is working with allies in campaigners in borrowing countries who are trying to hold their governments to account. And one of the problems for them in doing that is that the lenders are very untransparent in the loans that they give. So there's been a scandal in Mozambique, which I think we've been talking to some of you about for quite a while, where London banks lent money secretly, which was then effectively wasted and stolen. And we want, again, regulations on lenders to force them to be transparent, so to make lending and borrowing more responsible so that people can be held to account. So those are a couple of the specific changes we're looking for in relation to debt. And then we could go on and talk for a much longer time about other changes in the global economy around tax justice, ending this dependence on raw materials. There's lots of other big structural things as well.
Okay, brilliant. Thank you very much for that, Tim. Okay, so I'm going to kind of widen it back out now, I think, to both of you. And Sarah, there were just a couple that came in that maybe touch more on sort of the household debt issue as well, just and also including what where to go for advice if you're worried about debt.
Sure. Yeah, thanks very much for asking that question. So that I guess the most important point is that if you are worried about debt, go and get advice as soon as you can. The sooner that you get help, the sooner things can be sorted. There's lots of places to go to get debt advice. In the lockdown context, we would mostly recommend calling National Debt Line, which is a helpline run by the Money Advice Trust. And they've got some really fantastic debt advisors. We also recommend Step Change. They also have an advice line. And post-lockdown, you can go to your local Citizens Advice Bureau and speak to somebody face-to-face. I was saying that the problem for resolving the system for insolvency and resolving debt problems is not very good, but actually debt advisors have a massive impact helping people to negotiate with their lenders, to get debt payments down to a manageable level, trying to protect your credit record. So just go and get help as soon as you can. And there's more information on those debt advice providers on our website. I also just respond to Dan pulled me up on something in the chat box on student debt, and he was totally right to do so. So I think I gave the impression that there wasn't a kind of poverty dimension to student debt, which is obviously not true at all. And Dan mentioned that the burden of student debt falls disproportionately on students with lower incomes, and then people who go on, who have a university education, but then go on to have low incomes, and that's really important. What I meant was in our prioritization of where we could have the most impact on the connection between debt and poverty, the working around unsecured debt, which is things like loans, high cost credit, credit cards, came to the top of the priority list. But it's definitely not that we don't think that there's a big poverty and a big justice dimension to student debt. So thanks for highlighting that. Was there any other questions that you wanted me to pick up, Eva?
I think maybe if you could just say a little bit about how we're sort of working with allies, particularly sort of Positive Money, and maybe you can both touch on that a little bit as well.
Sure. So at the moment, so we work really closely with a lot of different economic justice organisations and social justice organisations. The main way that we're coordinating at the moment with Positive Money is in a conversation around how to pay for the government responses that are needed to tackle the economic impacts of COVID-19 and also to kickstart the economy afterwards. So obviously the government's been borrowing lots of money, which is fine because the government debt is actually at record low interest rates. The government can borrow a 10-year gilt, which is basically like a 10-year loan at, what is it, Tim, 0.35% at the moment. So obviously that is a really important source of money for helping us tackle the crisis. Positive money, they work on monetary financing, so the power of the Bank of England to create money. So we're working closely with them, and also Tax Justice UK, who work on tax and making the tax system more progressive. So at the moment we have a really regressive tax system. People tax more for income than they are for wealth. So as three organisations, we're in conversations about what's the relative role of debt and tax and printing money, monetary financing and funding the recovery. But Positive Money supported us with that letter, and we're in a kind of longer term kind of ongoing discussion around economic justice and how we transform the economy so that it's fairer and more sustainable in this country.
Okay, brilliant, thank you for that. Tim, is there anything else you want to come back on, and then I think we might have to wrap up?
Should I just say about the allies as well?
Yeah, that would be great.
I one thing I should have mentioned is that we worked with groups internationally to get over 200 organisations globally signed on to our campaign for the immediate debt cancellation. And I know some of people from those organisations are on the webinar, so I feel like I should definitely highlight how we've been working internationally and the regional groupings. And we have one in Europe, there's one in Latin America, in Africa and Asia. So there's a lot of international coordination happening. But then in the UK, we've seen a lot of the larger aid organisations and groups get involved. So we've been working over the last few weeks with Christian Aid, CAFOD, Global Justice Now, Oxfam, Save the Children, One, Avaz. And so that does help us in getting more reach. But I think it's to be quite not very British about this, but to blow our own trumpet, it's why it's really important that Jubilee Debt Campaign exists, because they've been coming for us to us with all the advice on what now to do and to understand what's happening. And it's because of that we've been able to both mobilize our supporters but mobilize their supporters, and we're hoping that that will continue, and that will help us get some of the bigger changes that we're pushing for.
Brilliant. Thank you very much for that. Okay, I think we might actually have to wrap up pretty much now. So I think, sorry if we didn't get to some of the questions in there. We'll kind of endeavour to come back on some of those ones that we didn't get to. But I guess just to say that we have quite a lot of questions beforehand on how people can get more involved in the campaigning. And I'd say, obviously, we're all kind of working from our front rooms at the moment, so there's not much in the way of big events that we can kind of invite people to, or kind of big protests, but we are going to be doing more of these webinars, and also the best way to stay in touch is just to go to the website and go to the campaign section and either sign up online or take action. There's lots of actions you can take there, and lots of resources and lots of things to read, so that's a great way to stay in touch. And then we'll be in touch and be able to email you when there's kind of opportunities to influence on some of these issues. So I'll just yes, and definitely there are local groups in a couple of different areas as well, which we'd highly encourage people to get involved in. So I just say thank you very much. Like, thank you so much for all the interaction and all the really great questions. And I guess, I believe it's Tim and Sarah to say thanks and goodbye also. I guess the main message is there's, we've achieved loads of things on debt, even in this crisis. And but there's going to be lots more to do, both internationally and in the UK. So. But you know, we know that we're having a real impact. So thank you very much for all the campaigning. Goodbye from me.
Bye.
Bye. Thanks everyone for joining.
Thanks so much.
Catch you all soon.
Cool. Bye everyone.